We'll call the meeting back to order. And I have the first motion. I have a motion from Doug Hutchison, second by Rob Thompson. Be it resolved that the council, Municipality of West Gary hereby returns to open session of council at 7 o'clock p.m. Any questions or comments on the motion? Call for the vote. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Go to another pen. And Mark, you let the minutes show that there's no matters arising from closed session, and only that matter that we went into closed session was the only matter discussed. Public meetings. We have no public meetings this evening. No matters arising from closed session. We have no public meeting. Consent agenda. I have a motion moved by Don B. Marshall and seconded by Bev Cutting. Be it resolved that items A1 to C1, inclusive, contained in Part 1 consent agenda, be adopted as amended. Is that as amended or as printed? Okay. Well, mover and seconder agreeable that I change that as amended to printed. Just a clerical. And further, that authorization be given for actions to be taken as may be necessary to give effect to the recommendations contained therein. Any questions or comments on the motion? Call the question. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Okay. All right, Mark, you can hand out those motions to give effect. And I'll sign. And that brings us down to the regular part of the agenda. And looking for, is there any communications from councillors or the mayor? Any councillors have any communications? Councillor Lawrence, Carol?
Thank you. Just a few. The airport, COPA, actually, had the Young Flyers yesterday. And I don't have the numbers, but there were calls from all over, from quite a distance, that were bringing their kids up for the flights, which is great. The Newstead Village-wide yard sale was successful. There was actually 36 homes, 36 families had things out and brought a lot of people into the village. The Ellenwood group that's looking at refurbishing the kitchen there toured our Aiton and Newstead arenas, looking at the kitchens. And Newstead had the 150 chairs plus delivered to the arena that the Recreation Committee has purchased. And lastly, the Aiton Fashion Show was a week ago Sunday, a fundraiser for the homecoming, and it was fabulous. Mary Lou, I think, organized it and did everything for it, but it was great. It was beautifully decorated, the food was lovely, and the fun, it was just so much fun. So it was great. It was a good job, Mary Lou.
Thank you, Carol. Anyone else? Doug, Councillor Hutchison.
Yeah, just a few items. Last meeting I was at the Stothard Hall. They're gearing up for their Canada Day celebrations on July 1st, so that's coming up. I know there's a few others in the area. The Lions Club's coming up this weekend in Durham, and I guess the Eaton will have a number of things going on there, so I'll let someone else speak to that. Just past weekend, the herb fair was very successful, rejuvenated, and thanks to Durham Horticultural Society and the committees involved there, that it went over very well. Also, this past week on Wednesday, June 15th, there was a health study that was taking part, and actually Wednesday was the day that they were in Durham taking blood samples. So hopefully people took the opportunity to participate in that. It's a long-term study, and they're going to look at a number of issues regarding to health and what causes some of the conditions we have today. And so people can still get involved. If you want to go online, you can fill out the survey online. And you just have to take, they'll get a requisition, and you can take take that to a life lab, and they'll do a blood sample. So you don't have to do it on that day, but it just happened that they had a day in Markdale and a day in Durham to try to collect samples and get participation. So hopefully that was successful. I know there were a number of local people involved there. And tomorrow is the longest day of play. So there's a number of our local schools involved that they have, I've given some swag to them, and so they're going to take part. There's going to be a field day or play day, just some way of getting the kids active, and we encourage them to do that all year round. So that's some of the things that I have.
Okay, thanks, Doug. Any other counselors? Bev? Are you two going to argue about which one wants to speak? Just have one of you speak, please.
We're not arguing. We're discussing.
Debate. Thank you.
I attended along with Rob Thompson, Mayor Eccles, Carol Lawrence, and myself to the police chief's retirement party on Saturday night, and it was well attended, and food was great, and the entertainment was good, and he had a great time, and that's what it was all about, and he was very thrilled with people who spoke and everything that went on. So the cake was fabulous. It was done in a police shirt, a West Gray chief's police shirt design. It was phenomenal. So he had a really good time, and it was a good turnout. So.
Okay, thanks. Was that Rob?
I was just going to remind everyone that this Sunday is Decoration Day at the Durham Cemetery. Starts at 2:00. At the cemetery, if the weather holds, and by all looks, it's supposed to rain on Sunday. So if it does rain, we'll be at the town hall in Durham at 2:00. So just remind everyone. And I guess we won't meet until after the homecoming in Eaton. Normby is on the July 1st weekend. So all kinds of events are planned, and things have moved ahead quite nicely. So yeah, long weekend this July is homecoming.
Very good. Thank you. Anyone else? On Saturday, and I'd like to say very good, I started the day out with manual labor. Not only at home, but once I got that, some of the jobs done for Joanne. Bruners, John and Pat Bruner at Elmwood, our crown rust application. And Crown does a make-a-wish car wash. So the mayor of Brockton and myself, I think we were there for 2 hours, and we managed to get, I think it was 14 cars done by the time we left. And yes, the brush that John gave us, I thought I was successful. I broke the handle once, but no, he had extra handles, so just kept pushing. Very good day for them and the firemen. The Elmwood Fire Department set up the barbecues, and we're having hamburgers as well too. So a good day there for the Bruners and their Make-A-Wish Foundation. I haven't heard nationally what they ended up with, but last year I think it was well in excess of $40,000, and they were planning. Crown was planning on having more of that this year. The COPA, I stopped into the airport on Saturday because they were flying. Very thankful and a thoughtfulness out to the pilots themselves. For the registrants, we're from Orillia, Peterborough, Windsor, KW, Guelph, kids coming from all over. And what it was the Canadian Owners and Pilots Association puts it on, where you register and they'll take children up for half an hour, is it, Carol, or 20 minutes, half an hour? And the pilots do that all on their own dime as well, too. So quite busy out at the airport with everybody flying, and great day, especially great weather for them to fly as well, too. Then as well on Saturday, the Diamond Project. Rob, I thought you might have meant something on the diamond fixing up. I know you weren't there, but recreation in Durham. The baseball day, all of the minor ball teams played a game. Especially noted then at 4:00, the athletes of days gone by played. That'd be the best way to put it. the dedication and what they've done down there, the new uniforms for Durham Minor Ball, West Gray, the Dodgers is what they're going to call themselves, and then the former Waltons and Beer Olympians, the Chiefs and the Grateful Dead combined. There was, had to get four teams to get enough for two teams to play ball, participated in that, and they had an individual who played on two All-Ontario ball teams here in Durham, toss out the first pitch to get the new diamonds going. They've still got work and that they want to do down there. But Cease Baines, it's good to see Cease come down, who grew up on top of the hill and spent a lot of his youth, not only in the hockey arena, but certainly on the ball diamond as well, too. And then had to quickly take a bit of a shower, because even just running once down to first base created a sweat, to go to Chief Berger's retirement function. And thank you to retired, is it Deputy Chief Retired or Retired Deputy Chief? It's Deputy Chief Retired Rob Thompson and a few others, Rhonda Eagles, for putting that together. The Chief was greatly appreciated. A week ago Tuesday, met with the senior policy advisor, a number of politicians and farm group organizations met with OFA in Walkerton. The policy advisor for OFA will give us an update on the Conservation Act, the Niagara Escarpment Act. Both of those acts are being reviewed at this point in time by the provincial government. What the OFA was putting in there or wanted to see in their updates, those are still open for comment. I believe it is until June 30th. There's a few more days left to get comment in on that, and I could be slightly off, and it might be a little bit longer. And then there was a good discussion on Bill 100, which is the Trails Act. And according to OFA, who had a fair bit of input developing that, and even some conservative MPPs are very supportive of it. The biggest thing that has been misinterpreted, this individual said, the biggest misinterpretation is that, you know, you can have a trail, snowmobile, ATV, walking, skiing, you can give permission. You do not have to have it registered as an easement. If you want to register that, it is voluntary. It is not mandatory. There is no mandatory in it whatsoever. It's if you've got a snowmobile trail in the back of your property and you want to put it in for 99 years, you may not own the property, but you can, but it is voluntary. And I think that's the biggest misinterpretation of that there. Look forward to the Durham Cemetery dedication, but as always, there's a dozen different things going on. That day is the Conservation, Saugeen Valley Conservation Foundation, their tree grove, the Memorial Tree Grove. It's their dedication as well, too. And I believe 2 o'clock is the time for both of them, right, Rob?
Yes.
Yeah. So we'll see whether we, yeah, which way we get back and forth there. So we'll be talking to you on that one, Rob. Okay. Anything else? And of course, coming up July 1st, before we meet again, Priceville, and this Saturday, Durham has their Durham Loves Canada Day celebrations. And then in Ayton on, again, July 1st, they're having a big fireworks display for their homecoming grand opening and the parade starting at 11 o'clock, Carol?
11.
And the whole day's festivities, and that's on July 1st is the Friday, and Priceville as well, too. So hopefully we can get to both of those at various times. We won't see the fireworks unless there's something spectacular. You're going to have to be in one or the other. I don't think we'll see Aitons in Priceville or Priceville's in Aitons. That's a little bit too much. Okay, if there's nothing else, then that's great for that. Delegations. What do we get on for delegations?
Is
Yeah. Is Mr. Bradley?
Yes.
Sorry.
Or Wallace? Oh, okay.
Because I know Jan Chamberlain. We've got Jan Chamberlain down here, and I'm... Yep. We can cut that one off. Yeah, Jan's not here. So David and/or Wally, whoever wants to take, we're pleased to have you here this evening.
And we'll just get the PowerPoint set up. We do a PowerPoint.
There is a PowerPoint that you have there. Should be the gray button on the microphone. There
you got it.
You are being recorded now, Dave, so everything you say...
Actually, I'm Wally.
Sorry, Wally. Sorry.
That's all right.
I apologize.
No, that's fine. David and Jan were on the agenda. David is here.
Yes.
David Bradley and Mary Lou Pepper and Kathy Brown. They're also from the Council on Aging. Hopefully I can see what's up on the screen when I'm going here. There we go. So, good evening, Your Worship. Thank you for allowing us to make this presentation, Your Worship, councillors and staff. Council on Aging, Grey Bruce, Owen Sound, and we can click. It started out, there was a senior summit that was planned, organized, and sponsored by the Active Lifestyles Center in Owen Sound, which is the original Owen Sound Seniors. The purpose of the summit was to gauge the interest in older adults in Grey and Bruce counties in forming their own Council on Aging. When that was held, we kept hearing from everybody, it was about time that somebody looked at it. So the funding, the Council on Aging Grey Bruce Owen Sound startup was through a funding that was done through Active Lifestyles Center Grey Bruce. They applied for it. The funding was received in November of 2014, and as you're aware, there's always conditions with any funding. The condition being that we had to have our first meeting and in place by March 30th of 2015. So right away, didn't receive it till the latter part of November 2014. So in December, started to set up a steering committee. Steering committee started meetings in January of 2015, and we did hold our meeting by them in the March. The initial approach we took was we broke it into four different, actually five different districts. There was North Bruce, South Bruce, East Grey, West Grey, and Owen Sound. And then the steering committee held information and sessions in all of these areas, took applications from people interested in sitting on the Council of Aging Grey Bruce Owen Sound and or on community advisory committees. And then we held the first meeting in March the 30th of 2015. Okay. The board at the Active Lifestyles, as well as the steering committee, sat down. They selected three applicants from each one of the five areas for a total of 15 members to sit on the Council of Aging board, as well as one representative from the USCO, the United Senior Citizens of Ontario. Zone 9, which David Bradley happens to be the representative for, as well as USCO Zone 32, which 32 Doug Walsh from Chesley is the representative for, and it's basically Highway 21 and up that he covers. So there was a total of 17 members on the board. Okay. The process on this, the collective voice for seniors in Grey Bruce, the whole idea was promote a master aging plan for Grey Bruce Owen Sound. So process to create a gap analysis within municipalities according to the age-friendly community guidelines and prioritizing the actions needed to close the gaps in the analysis. And the goal is to set up a network of age-friendly committees that can reach into every area of Grey Bruce Owen Sound and to invite residents to participate in the Master Aging Plan. There is abundant educational programs out there, and they're through a lot of organizations. The big thing is to get them the local facilities to hold these events is a challenge, and that we've worked out some partnerships with the Royal Canadian Legion, as well as with some seniors clubs to be able to help do that. Plans were to make presentations to Grey and Bruce County councils, as well as all the municipalities who were interested. We have done the presentation to the Bruce County Council. We did a presentation to the Gray County Social Services Committee. We have done presentations to, I was up, we did on sound. We also did the Healthy, Community Healthy Networks Partnership and on sound. And so with our system, our lead in with the Legions and with the seniors groups, we can help support municipalities of trying to have meetings. And I mean, municipalities certainly have meeting spaces as well, but we're certainly able there to help out to do some work with them. Okay. The question on the community advisory committees. The community advisory committees basically will be the heart and soul of the organization. They're going to be interfacing with all the senior residents and solicit the input for the master aging plan. And as I was saying earlier, there's hundreds of programs and services provided by the province through our healthcare system and other organizations. The real key is to making sure our residents know where they can get that help, where it's available, and how to access those programs and services. And one of the things I quite often ask, and I did it again on the weekend, I was at a couple different events, I was asking people if they've ever heard of 211, and it's surprising the number of people that haven't. And that's a service that's out there that's a wonderful service for anybody. Okay, so these are the eight items that are part of the age-friendly communities. It's WHO is the World Health Organization, so that's what the definition of WHO is there. That basically, these key elements, these eight key elements, it wouldn't matter where you went in the world, these are the eight key elements that they want to see people meet. So the outdoor spaces and public buildings, the major impact on mobility, independence, quality of life, accessibility for daily activities. Transportation, accessible and affordable for everyone. That's an issue up here with the rural area. There's SMART, there's a number of different ones around. One of the things that has been done, and you're probably all aware of it, is the Moving GB, which is Moving Great Bruce. That is an organization that's there that is already working on that. One of the things we do believe in is not duplicating. It's just a case of communicating. If they're there and doing that, why, you know, why interfere? They're doing a good job of trying to get that done. So housing, again, this is proximity of service. I was going to mention Rockwood, but I'm not going to.
Well, you already have. Go on.
I know. But it's to have those services close by for people and to have it close by for family and everybody. Social participation, interaction with other members of the community to make sure that that's available to everybody. Respect and social inclusion for everybody. Civic participation and employment. The big thing there is just to be able to get them out into the to participate in civic activities. And believe it or not, there is a number of people that, due to circumstances, the way things have gone, some of them want to still work part-time, some of them want to volunteer here and there, and it's to get that information out there and find those people that and give them the opportunity to do that. Communication and information. The ability to stay connected. It's always an issue up here in remote areas to get any kind of internet connections out there. And so that's another thing on the radar for them. The information's available in accessible formats to make sure that it is so that they can understand it. And it's in layman's terms so they know what it is. Community support and health services. Again, sufficient, good quality, appropriate, and accessible care. And that's whether it's your hospitals, your seniors' homes, your medical clinics, everything. It's there, it's good quality, it's accessible, and again, going back to the transportation, that they can get to it. Okay. The proposals to the councils and municipalities. If we're We've got a number of municipalities that have asked us to make these presentations, and again, I thank you for allowing us here tonight. The whole idea is we can help assist the municipalities in setting up the community advisory committees in all of the 17 communities. Each community advisory committee would then elect one member, or certainly one member of volunteer or whatever, to sit on the Council on Aging Board. And this would provide the representation back up to the initial Council on Aging Grey Goose on Sound. The information sessions will provide some background and sharing of ideas to municipal residents and distribute applications for those interested in volunteering to sit on the committees and volunteering to help set up these. The support municipalities as far as applications to the Ontario Senior Secretariat or sources to fund the implementation, excuse me, for the community advisory committees and their work on the municipal aging plans. I've done a number of different talks with the Ontario Senior Secretariat, New Horizons, a number of those. There are grants out there to help with some of this stuff, and we would certainly be more than willing to help as a committee to help somebody on the at the municipality to do that. The municipal plans would then roll up to a master aging plan at the county level, and then and that would be embedded into the counties. The recommendations by the municipal aging plans would be reviewed and approved by the council and municipal councils before being implemented and credited to their age-friendly community development strategy. And one of the big things is we would encourage the municipalities to embed the age-friendly communities planning into their strategic plans, thus providing the sustainability to the ongoing age-friendly communities process. Unless it's, as I said before, I've talked to the Ontario Senior Secretariat, I've talked to New Horizons, all of these, we got a grant originally to set up this to go out and take a look and garner the interest. Now what they are looking at is they need to know that there's something behind them in order to maintain the sustainability down the road. Because as you know, with most grants, they're good at getting it started, and then you have to continually work on stuff in order to keep it going. So that's basically the idea, is to embed it into the strategic plans so that when you take a look at those eight items, every time you decide to do something, you look at those eight items and see, okay, does it meet any of these? Is it another one of our credits towards being an age-friendly community? Again, I thank you very much for allowing us to make the presentation. And if there is any questions, I'll try and answer them. If I don't have the answers, I'll look over at David, and if neither one of us have them, we'll find them.
It's always a good to have that ability to defer to somebody. Are there any questions, Council? Doug, Councillor Hutchison.
So question comes to mind is, so what are you looking for from us? You're looking to set up a community advisory committee in West Grey? Is that the purpose here?
Yeah. Okay. And it's to garner the interest from the municipality, from you, the council. If you're interested in setting up a community advisory committee for a council on aging, whether you're even interested in being an age-friendly community, whether this is something that you may think would be of benefit to the community. It certainly, in my opinion, and I might be a little biased, but certainly an age-friendly community, because age-friendly is not just seniors. Age-friendly is cradle to grave. So, I mean, we've had meetings where people have said, you know, the sidewalks, it's got to be accessible for new mothers to be able to get down that sidewalk with a carriage. That's not just a baby carriage, but now you want senior, you've got seniors with walkers, you've got people in wheelchairs, access to buildings, access to all the services that are available. And we're certainly willing to work with somebody from the office to see if there's anything we can do to help. I know it's a bit vague for you.
you were, part of that, maybe I missed it, there's municipalities out there that are, you know, certified youth-friendly and all of that. Is there this designation you speak of, is there a bar that you've got to meet to get to that, that we can put on, I guess get Eunice to put it on the sign out here, we're certified youth-friendly.
Yeah. And age-friendly is meeting those eight criteria. And that is, Hanover is in the process, has been for about a year, a little over a year. Gray Highlands just started on theirs. And what they're looking towards are those eight items. And again, this goes back to most municipalities, like, and you guys can tell me better, you folks can tell me better than I can, but in most cases, the staff, when they prepare something for you, it has to meet some of the items in your strategic plan. You have to check it off and see, does this meet? This is where this here, these eight items, if they could check those eight items off every time something came forward to council, then those are all credits towards the age-friendly communities. The Hanover is working with the University of Waterloo. They have a template, and they have, the university does. They have the template that they worked from, and they're more than willing to work with anybody else. Town of Hanover, they got their grant. Their grant was basically went to the people at the university to do the study, to come forward to make they launched it back in the spring. And we just had a meeting, I think it's probably a month and a half ago, I was there for a meeting with them. And they're still working on it. They're flagging places within Hanover that, yes, this is good. This is a place where they need to look at to improve to meet one of those eight criteria.
Okay. So once you meet those eight criteria, there's a ministry that comes and
that's
does this all
my understanding. The World Health Organization, once you meet that, they will authorize you to say you're an age-friendly community if you've met those.
Okay. Interesting. And you did mention on the transportation, we're one of the founding members, or still one of the board members. I think maybe we might even have the chair of Smart Transit sitting here close by, Mr. Bell.
I believe so.
So I'm wondering, you know, how much in that transportation with that, and I know Moving Gray Bruce is provincially funded. Smart has some provincial funding as well, too. I guess I'm trying to struggle with.
There's a good chance you already meet the transportation side of it. But the question will come, and I know that SMART covers all of this area.
Correct.
Pretty well.
No, it covers all of West Gray.
Yeah, West Gray does, I think. But I've had the question raised to me, what about the people that can't afford it? And I think it's pretty affordable now. But there are those that have a difficulty with that. I had an opportunity actually at the Hanover meeting. There was somebody there that worked at one of the nursing homes, not here, that said that there was transportation available for their residents, but there were some there that held off doing doctor appointments and stuff like that because they didn't have the money that week or the next week. For the next week until the end of the month when the check come in. So there's all those are the items that you have to look at as far as transportation and how do we meet those or what can be done to accommodate.
Okay, very good. Doug?
Yeah, just looking at the eight key elements, like I'm struggling with the whole idea how there must be some criteria that's measurable in this. So in order, like you're talking transportation or housing, so in order to be certified or qualified for housing, you must meet step one, step two, step three. Is that, am I wrong on that, or is that...
Yeah, I don't have those criteria with me, and I wouldn't even want to start trying to guess what they are.
Right.
But it's something I can certainly try and find out and get it sent back to the council.
Well, I'm just wondering, that study that Hanover is doing through the university, is that not something they're doing in terms of what are the criteria, what are the things that make up these key elements?
That's what they're doing right now. The university is working on that plan so that they can check those off, and then they can help them meet that criteria.
Right.
And that, to me, is where municipalities, you know, there's no sense asking me to do it for you or do it.
No.
Because I don't understand all the criteria that they do.
Right.
But that's what they're doing, and that's what their whole focus is.
Right.
So their template is laid out in order to meet that.
Right. And I would have trouble for our staff or our council trying to measure something if we don't know what it is we're measuring.
Yeah. You can't get from A to B if you don't know how you're supposed to get there.
So with criteria, then you can do
that. And that's where the university, I think, and that's what I would certainly recommend to any municipality, if they're looking at, if that's what they want to do in, is age friendly. And like I said, it's cradle to grave. It's to keep everybody here. It's to keep everybody. Is to look at somebody that's got that knowledge, and they've got the software. They actually invented the software to lay all this out. There are other universities. University of Guelph is doing it for other municipalities as well. So, but that would be the where to start. And then once you, it's like anything, if you want a grant, you have to have a budget. So once you look at them and see what it's going to cost to do it, to have them do it, then you can take that budget and apply for the grant to move forward.
Very good. Deputy Mayor Bell, John?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Wally, thanks for your presentation. And David gave a great presentation at Gray County also. This is the second time I've seen it, and I got a little bit more out of it. The one thing I wanted to know, from your perspective, the GB ride, is that being received very well? And are there people who have access and like that more than they do Smart? Or do you think there should be one operation in the region? Or do you think there's room for both players? That, and you'll probably know more about it than I will.
No, that's a load of question coming for you.
Both services
are good, and both services complement each other. I think the moving GB, again, it's government funded, or certainly has a certain amount of government funding around it, and it's being run through that. It's got the phone numbers out there. Again, not everybody knows that it exists. We've been at meetings where they don't know it exists. Even Smart, there are some people that don't realize they exist, and they certainly should, because it's been advertised. That you see it in the paper. I just read an article not very long ago on it. But I think they complement each other, and Smart can work with GB, moving GB, because it can help maybe filter some of the clients in that area to Smart. I mean, Smart's been on a long time. It's done a wonderful job. It's been a great organization to have around.
Very good. Anything else? Well, Wally, and to the rest of the board, thank you very, very much. I'm looking probably at this as being a topic coming up at one of our Committee of the Whole meetings, and as to where we want to, or how deeply we want to get into this. There's no question I want to get older, so I deeply am concerned about it.
I'm surprised he wants to get older.
Well,
stay as young as you can.
Yeah, the alternative isn't really good.
Stay as young as you can.
I don't mind staying as young as I can, but that means day by day getting older. So looking forward, and I guess the thing I'm saying is we will be, as a council, as a committee, looking at it into the future of how we can go about that and where we want to go with it. So,
yeah. And it's not something that happens overnight. Age-friendly communities is something that takes years.
Yep.
Years.
It grows.
The whole idea is to get it there where it's part of the plan, where you look at it And as you go through, it's not to go out and spend a whole lot on trying to do this or that. It's to make sure that everything meets as you go through it, as you go through the processes.
Yep. And I'm very thankful that, you know, West Gray is mentioned in there just specifically. I thought that was wonderful. Tactical.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're age friendly, Bob. Come on. Yeah. Okay, well, thank you very much. And of course, it is a public meeting open. If you really. That seems to be the answer an awful lot. No, appreciate it very much, that. Let staff get back to their seats. Okay. Okay, is there any business arising from the previous meeting? Not aware of any. All right, then we'll get down to staff reports. And our first report coming from our treasurer, Director of Finance, Carrie. Welcome this evening. I understand that you've been doing a bit of driving this afternoon, so good for you. What page does this start on? 60, 43, 42. There we are. Let me get to there. There we are. First on Carrie's report is the approval of the voucher number 11, 2016. And just wondered, are there any questions? The report's been there in the package. Councillor Lawrence, Carol.
Thank you. Just the chairs, Carrie, at Newstead, and it's showing it coming from the Newstead Arena capital expense. Do you then reimburse that from the fundraising? Because it is to come out of fundraising.
Yeah, so. We'll transfer the funding over from the fundraising account, because I think that was close to $5,000.
Yeah, with the tax, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
52, I think it was. Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Okay. And again, one of those options where the community group reinvesting back into our community infrastructure. Very good. Thanks, Carol. Any other questions? Doug?
Page 47, Carrie. I'm feeling a little left out that Councillor Marshall and ourselves didn't get a chance to reimburse for our lunches. I'm just wondering if that's something new, or is it just going to come out at a later date on page 47?
If you had submitted any expenses for reimbursement, then we would have credited the payment back for the lunches, but if there was no expense claim submitted, then there was nothing to offset it against.
Very good. Anything else? The resolution is moved by Bev Cutting, second by Carol Lawrence. Be it resolved that the Director of Finance Treasurer be authorized to pay the accounts presented as voucher number 11, 2016 of the Municipality of West Gray in the amount of $2,723,614.45. Any questions on the motion? Call the question then. All those in favor? Any opposed? That is carried. Okay. The next one, Carrie, number two, is the Rocky Saugeen Cemetery. We have got a request for another cemetery that is struggling to make ends meet and have individuals look after us. I guess that's about the best way to look at it. We've had a number of these requests in the last 4 to 5 years, I think is when it's really picked up. So anything else?
Mostly abandoned cemeteries, the other ones. This one is still active.
Active.
Very little activity, but there is individuals who still hope to be buried in the cemetery there.
Yep. There's plots that have been purchased and will be active that way. Would that, in taking it over and obviously operating under that, as the municipality operating a cemetery here, and you just said, I would hesitate to say, but there's probably one or two burials there every year or every other year up at the Rocky Cemetery. Okay. The thought process is that it would probably flow through our cemetery care from Durham to kind of look after that?
Durham is totally separate. Eaton is totally separate. We'll be meeting with them this week to see what kind of funds they have to transfer along with the cemetery. But I don't think it's that strong of a fund by any means to assist. Eventually, we will advertise rate changes. We'll look at that to see so that when there's burials in there, they're at least covering the cost of providing the
interment
service. But we'll have to look at all of that and get a handle on where they're sitting. But worst case, then it starts to, if there's no, I don't know how large their fund may be that's transferring, it could be fairly small.
Oh. And confirm for me if my interpretation on the act, if the cemetery was abandoned, the act says that the municipality shall take it over. And this is a little proactive here that it is, yeah, before they have to file for abandonment. I think they're looking at being proactive. And so for any of the individuals out there in the audience or on media tomorrow, it reverts to us one way or the other. So this is working with the individuals to transfer it over with some knowledge before it becomes abandoned. Okay. Anything else on the report then, Kerry? No. I do have a motion. The resolution's been moved by John A. Bell, seconded by Rob Thompson. Be it resolved that the Council of the Municipality of West Grey hereby approves the transfer of the responsibility for the care and control of the Rocky Saugeen Cemetery to the Municipality of West Grey, subject to all assets, financial and administrative records being transferred to the municipality. Any questions on the motion? Call the question. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Very good. Any further comments, Kerry? Any questions for Kerry at this point in time? Oh, Doug, go ahead.
Just a question of interest. So whose portfolio, who looks after the cemeteries when they come to us then? So that would be part of your job then, Kerry?
Sort of. whenever someone comes in, they want to be buried. If they were looking, I don't believe there's plots that we'll be selling there, but under the current one, one of our secretaries is the secretary for the Durham Cemetery, so she looks after a lot of it. As far as our most active cemetery. Aiton is our other operating cemetery. It's less active. It's probably 2 to 3 burials in a year, maybe, but. They come to the office here, and between Heather and I,
So we have staff that do have that as part of their portfolio. Okay, thank you.
And just a little bit of personal knowledge. The reason I was asking that question, I know in years gone by when there was burials that it was kind of subcontracted with the individual that had some experience at the Durham Cemetery. Yes. And I think that that's what they've done since then. It's been a subcontract, not through the municipality, but the individual themselves of having some knowledge of that type of work, which, so, probably you would see that, but it's not ours. It was coming through the Rocky, so it may be a closer relationship now that we are in operations of the cemetery. Okay. All right. There's no other questions then, Carrie. She will be staying fully through, I can imagine. Any ball, no ball games tonight, or? No, okay, then you're fine. Thank you, Carrie. Down then to Public Works and Infrastructure. And Brent's with us. And the first one is the real-term energy contract. Council had made the motion to put this forward and go with the light replacement with the LED lighting. And then there was on the descriptive for decorative lights. And so there's a recommendation there. Brent, you have one. Any other comments, thoughts on it? Pretty self-explanatory.
Yes, I believe so, Mr. Mayor. If council has any questions regarding the contract, I will try and answer those questions. There's a few outstanding items that I have to collect from them, such as the insurance. But I need a copy of their policy for the file and WSIB clearance, the regular things that go with contracts. So that'll be left up to me to gather up those documents.
Any questions on this, on the bylaw? Because it'll be done by bylaw later in the meeting. So it's just here for any questions before we get to that. We're good? Okay. And that was all, I think, there, wasn't it? Oh, no, sorry. There's a couple more down here. So go ahead, Brent, with the next one on basically update on the work summary. Where we are with Owen King, surface treatment. You've got it down here.
Yeah, I was anything just, else you want I was just providing it? Council information on the status of some of the projects. I've handed out some pictures for council review. The sidewalk is the Augusta Street in Ayton, and I'm told, well, it's in the report, they're finished the sidewalks in Ayton, Elmwood, and Newstead, and now they're starting the work in Durham. Surface treatment started on last Friday, and it's expected it will wrap up Wednesday. Pictures in there show concession 12, the asphalt repair to the approaches to the bridges and some of the rut repair work ahead of the surface treating work that's going to be completed this week. Council gave me permission at a previous meeting to provide that work. And grass cutting has started. I mean, the hay is quite long right now, so we've engaged the contractor. He's got Norm be completed. And is now proceeding into Bendick to finish in Glen Elg. Sorry, Mr. Deputy Mayor, that you're.
somebody has to be last.
Yeah, so it was just a informational things more than anything. Any questions? I'd be happy to answer them.
Any questions for Brent on the update? We are still looking at the Mew Creek Bridge grand opening with fireworks and everything else on July 1st? Or is there just more fireworks here?
I have a bunch of things that I have to get sorted out, but I believe we're still heading in that for that final grand opening, yes.
Okay. Any other questions? Don? Go ahead, Councillor Marshall.
There was a broken water main downtown this week by Godfather's Pizza.
Actually, Councillor Marshall, that was a broken sanitary service into Godfather's. It had backed up into their place. Steve was out the other day, and it was a direct result of a water main repair that had been completed, I think a year ago it was settlement. A large stone had come on top of the sanitary service and crushed it. So Steve was out last Friday. Yeah, he spent most of Friday morning doing that repair to that property.
So the company that repaired the water system is responsible for the sewer backup?
I'd have to check with Steve to see if it was our staff that did the repair work. I'll have to look into that. I'm not sure. I can't answer you right now. I'm sorry.
It's going to be a substantial bill to fix the sewer line, I think.
I'll look into it and I will get back to you.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions then for Brent? All right. And there's nothing else in for Brent. Mark, clerk's report, Southwest Oxford. They're a little upset with the Roma and Ogra boards separating and going to two different conferences and are requesting, is it mediation? They want us to step in and see if we can get them back together again.
Breaking up is hard to do.
Don't start singing that song. I guess you're asking, is there any comments or thoughts on that? Carol.
Can we receive it for information only?
I would think that. Yeah, both boards. I don't think there's anything for this year because I know that both boards have already booked and are committed to going separate ways. So for 2017, there will not be, it's going to be two separate conferences. And I do recognize some of the things they say in there, but it may take some experience to rectify if there is a problem. So Councillor Lawrence moves to receive for information. Seconder? Rob? All in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Okay. Mark, you've got that. City of Ottawa. Can't imagine they're talking about electrical systems there when they should be talking about sinkholes in the city. And looking for regulatory changes on the role of siting wind power. And Mark's looking for comment or thought on this. Anything from municipal wind? Carol?
Support this. It's interesting it's coming out of Ottawa.
Yeah. Well, there might be a thought. City of Ottawa is pretty large through amalgamation. You can think of the city, but there's a lot of farmland out to the outside of it there. It is large. Okay. Any other comments? Bev?
I was just going to make the comment that it's really nice to see a very large city supporting this, because 9 times out of 10 the city just, you know, Toronto just says, well, they're up there, so who cares? I'm really pleased to see, and hopefully this will encourage other cities to get involved as well. And what they're asking for is exactly the resolution that we sent in, asking for that to be a part of the approval process. So we to my mind, we have to support it.
Okay, thank you. I think if you go further down in this, you'll recognize they have, there's a lot of agricultural land that was incorporated or moved into the city of Ottawa at amalgamation time, and interestingly, it was their land. I just forget what the title of the committee is that's supporting it, but it's the agricultural. You hardly think of Ottawa, but it is part of that committee is agriculture. And as I said to the chair of the city of, sorry, yeah, there you've got it, City of Ottawa Agricultural and Rural Affairs Committee. And interesting that the mayor of Ottawa is a former minister in Mr. McGuinty's Liberal government, I think when the Green Energy Act was introduced. Any other questions or comments? I do have a motion then. It's moved by Carol Lawrence, seconded by Bev Cutting. Resolved that the Council and Municipality of West Gary hereby supports the resolution of the City of Ottawa Council requesting the province of Ontario to make the necessary legislative and or regulatory changes to provide municipalities with a substantive and meaningful role in siting wind power projects, and that the municipal support resolution becomes a mandatory requirement in the IESO, Independent Electricity Systems Operator, process. And further, that a supporting letter be forwarded to the Premier of Ontario, the Ministry of Environment and Climate Change, IESO, Rural Ontario Municipal Association, ROMA, Association of Municipalities of Ontario, AMO, and the City of Ottawa and local MPPs. Any further questions or comments on the resolution? Call the question. All those in favor? Any opposed? Declare that carried. Okay. The next one, Mark, you have a City of Hamilton Council. And this one is dealing specifically for the funding of programs and resources for autism and families. Is there any questions or comments from the council members on how they want to receive this? Resolution, Deputy Mayor Bell. John?
I'd support this, and the reason for this is autism is a disease that everybody knows about, and it doesn't go away, but this is children with autism aged 5 or older who no longer qualify for government-funded intensive therapy.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you get to 5 years old, you get a long way until you're 18 or 21, and I think there should be some support there. It's a debilitating disease, and they're going to live with it all their life, so I would think we should support this.
Okay. Well, there's the resolution there. Any other comments before I introduce the resolution? No? Okay. So I have the resolution. It's moved by John A. Bell and seconded by Doug Hutchison. Resolved that the Council and Municipality of West Gary hereby supports the resolution of the City of Hamilton Council requesting the province of Ontario to provide additional funding for programs and resources for individuals of all ages with autism and their families. And further, that a supporting letter be forwarded to the Premier of Ontario, Ministry of Community and Social Services, the Association of Municipalities of Ontario, AMO, and the City of Ottawa. City of Ottawa and local MPPs. I think, Mr. Bell, you mean the City of Hamilton, if I can do that. The clerk is cutting and pasting from the last. Not giving those secrets out. Sorry, Mark. Okay, and that's the City of Hamilton and local MPPs.
Thank you.
Very good. Any other questions on the resolution? Doug?
Comment. It's typical of another example of our government and cutbacks in education, whether it be through staffing or programs, whatever. So this is just another example, and it's unfortunate, but that seems to be the way they're going right now. So I do support it.
Okay, thank you. There's no other comments, then I'll ask for a vote. All those in favor? Any opposed? That is carried. Okay. Any other comments, Mark? Thoughts?
No other items under my report, but I will have four items under new business.
or through direct motion.
Okay. Any questions for Mark at this point in time? One thing, Mark will be around for the whole evening, so we can question him whenever. CAO Deputy Clerks, Larry.
Thank you, Your Worship. For Council's information, I'd like to thank Council for the opportunity to attend the AMCEO conference. Both Clerk Mark and I attended the conference, which had a great theme, seeing the big picture. There were some truly exceptional speakers. It was a great opportunity to network, and it was very much appreciated to be able to attend. I do have the agenda, if any, or the program, if anyone would care to have a look at it. It's in my office and available for perusal. So just as an FYI for Council.
Okay.
Second item is Durham Recreation upgrades. Randy reports that the new fence has been installed around the waiting pool. The health unit has been contacted to come and conduct their annual inspection and to formally authorize the pool opening. And we already have two bookings for next weekend for private parties. So the pool season is upon us, and we're working on that, as well as programming for the summer for swimming lessons and for summer programming as well, Your Worship. That's for Council's information as well.
Do you want to jump in, Mark? Mark?
Yeah, I was just going to mention there are some significant changes to the elections under the Modernization of Elections Act that was recently passed. The nomination day for municipal elections will be moving from January 1st to May 1st, and then the end of the nomination period, their nomination day will be now the fourth Friday in July, as opposed to, I think it was around September 10th. So quite a few changes, a lot of other changes that are designed to just bring up to date with technology, with the new voting systems such as internet or telephone voting, that kind of thing. So other mostly positive, I think in my mind, the one I didn't like too much is as a clerk, now I'm going to be responsible, and as our other clerks, to review financial statements and determine if they may not comply. And if they don't comply, then I submit those to the Compliance Audit Committee for review. So that, I know AMCTO tried to get that out of the legislation, but it remains. So I'll have to brush up on my treasury editing skills.
Doug?
That's a question to Mark on that. So the online voting, that's an optional, isn't it, coming up in the next election, online voting?
Definitely, like they call alternative voting methods. And there is, I also believe it's May of 2017 that a bylaw has to be passed to implement or to approve an alternate voting option. And I know our Greer County clerks are somewhat unanimous, or maybe even unanimous, in working towards internet and telephone voting for the next election. So we're in the process of probably getting a team together and working on procedures and policies for that. So that's something I may bring to Council and for some deliberation and discussion. We'll see if I continue as a clerk after I bring that to. But I think there's a lot of positives too. It's certainly for accessibility purposes, and there are available options to facilitate those that may not have internet. There are a lot of positives, some cons as any other system, but with the voter turnout of 28% last election, there has to be something different, and it's been in the mid-30s the previous two elections. So I think something has to be done to try to encourage a greater voter turnout. So unless the municipality really gets some controversial issues going to increase turnout, I think looking at those alternative methods would work well. Now, I did mention the 4th July of 2000 of the election or nomination day for 2018. Interesting thing is, question of lame duck came into play. Lame duck, obviously, nomination day was September 10th or 12th, and there are certain restrictions on what approvals and actions that Council can take during what's called that lame duck period. So now, in essence, it's going to be the end of July to Election Day, October 27th. So that's, they haven't actually dealt with that. There's going to be another regulation. I suspect there'll be a number of regulations that will implement the statute. So it should be interesting to see how they work around that.
Very good. Thank you, Mark, for that update. Anything else there, Larry, on the recreation updates?
No, not in recreation. I did want to reiterate that Tom did advise me of the purchase of the chairs, but Councillor Lawrence already brought that forward this evening. So the other item I have is the RFP for community impact study. I've not issued the RFP at this point in time. There was additional information which became available following our last meeting, and I'm actually going to request a resolution to defer that this RFP be submitted. I believe there's some additional work that needs to be done. We need to formalize a bit more and work with aligning ourselves with some of our neighbors. So I would respectfully request that we consider a motion to defer.
Carol, Councillor Lawrence.
Thank you. I was coming in from a little bit different angle than Larry on this, and there has certainly been some new additional information made available to us from expert outside professional sources. And we do really need to go on a much larger scope than what we had originally talked. And the county on their website, on their Q&A, are saying that they will do a socioeconomic study before they make a decision. So I was going to suggest that we perhaps rescind the motion that we put through on our community impact study and propose a new motion that we approach the county and other municipalities to cooperate and share in that study that the county is speaking of on their website. I'm sure that Grey Highlands is just as interested as we are in the outcome of that. Perhaps they would share. But we do have to, county, of course, being the first Tuesday of the month, if we were going to do that and put another motion forward to county, we should do it tonight. But, you know, it's going on, and I certainly hope that the information that they're saying is that they want to do the study is accurate, and they're not pushing the decision being made in this term.
From my understanding of it, that's where that they need to be able to get some type of information gathering study, however you want to describe it, going forward here in an expedient matter or manner, not so much as a matter. And anything else you want to add to that, John?
No, and for council's information, Mr. Adams and myself were asked to go and meet our counterparts at Grey Highlands this afternoon. And that was broached and that was discussed. And yes, they are also in support that they want to get the right information, get all of it, social information, as well as, well, we do have some financial information, but also some impact information as to what it does to the business community, both in Grey Highlands and in West Grey, being the two most affected. So yes, they are interested in, shall we say, slowing the process somewhat to get this information and make sure that the RFP is correct. And to Larry's credit, he has been working on that, but it's not ready, and with good reason, because he wants to make sure it gets out there right and get in the hands of the people that need to see it. So yes, if we can, not the only thing I have about the rescinding of the motion, it's still on the books. I'm just not sure if we want to rescind it and rush it through right now, but I think it is widely understood. And I know Kevin's had some, Mayor Eccles, excuse me, has had some conversations at the county with some individuals as to, shall we say, slowing things down a little bit and make sure we do this right.
Go ahead, Carol.
Well, I would agree if we can defer it, but there's no reason why we couldn't pass this other motion about approaching the county and other municipalities with regard to cooperating on a study. And maybe you're right, if we can defer it rather than rescind it, it's still on the books then, if we want to go through with it. But there certainly has to be much broader than what we had discussed first. And we did have some excellent advice from someone in this. And and if it could be pursued, obviously you've already spoken to Grey Highlands and pursued with the county, that we can get on it. The only thing my concern is, I don't want the county to steer the ship.
Yeah.
It's got to be mutually agreed what goes, the parameters set for that study. And so maybe if we need to lead it with Larry's, you know, the RFP's written up, or, and I'm not sure the county would agree to that.
I think they're wanting to back up a little bit, realizing that maybe the ship was maybe getting steered a little too fast.
Mm-hmm.
Would be my take on that, but go ahead.
Well, it's either the ship, I kind of disagree with you a little bit there, John. It's not that the ship is being steered too fast, that the ship is going too fast with nobody steering it at this point in time. And I'm going to look towards you, Larry. We have a committee of the whole meeting coming up next Monday, and we have another council meeting before county council. Yeah, the day before, but yeah, day, whatever. To get this resolution right on what we want to put into it, I guess we could start by saying, you know, we're deferring the resolution that was initially put in place. Deferring the action and have staff present us in consultation, just direct staff to be able to present and get direction to affirm that, defer it, the RFP, and develop an encompassing RFP in consultation with other partners. Is that
set? I think the county should be named, though, and others.
Directly, yeah, with county and other municipal partners.
Yeah.
Okay. Does that work within the time frame there, Larry? Or
yes, sure.
The doable?
I believe so, sir. Yes. The CAO from Greyhounds and myself have committed to have something prepared and ready for back for council next week or as soon as possible.
Okay. And I think that, and then be able to have us, to have something ready to present, could be presented as a direct motion at county council on the Tuesday after that information from the Lynns. But I think it would work well. We knew that something had to be done, and I think it was to get the actions out there. We may have jumped at it. Our council may have jumped and asked some of the right questions, but as we got into this, we knew there was more questions to ask and answers to find on the situation. So now that we've got a little bit more information, we're able to ask the right questions. Yeah. Okay. Understanding, yeah, that this is more than just economic, where we started out from, and we have expanded on that, so let's get it down. All right? Now, Mark, what do you feel, direction is there is fine?
So it'll be so noted in the minutes, the direction.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mark's got it here. Yeah, and then we could really have a good review on that motion that would go to council on July 4th? I think it is, right? Yep. Okay. Yeah. And county council is on the 5th. So we'll have that armed. Okay. Very good. No, we're great. All right. Anything else, Larry? Or sorry, Doug, did you have a question?
Sorry, I do
go
have
ahead, Doug.
A question,
yeah.
But
oh,
maybe, go Larry, go ahead if you had something else. I do have a question for you or Brent regarding waste management, but I'll
tell him he's ready.
I just wanted to advise council that I have met with the representative from the proponent in regards to waste management, and they are in the process of crafting a document for both Chatsworth and ourselves. Chatsworth has agreed to move forward with the process much as we have, provided we have those conditions in which were outlined at the last meeting. So that is moving forward, and I'm just in the process of waiting for that document to be crafted and returned.
So I guess my follow-up question to that is, One of the things that I'm missing, and maybe I missed it, but we used to send out an information sheet with the dates of pickups and so on with our waste management. I know that this contract thing has been holding that up, right? But there's a fair bit of information that comes out on that sheet with recycle days, and I also, I think there's also some recreation information. I don't know if that's part of your letter, Mr. Mayor, that you put out, but we're sort of behind the eight ball on that, right?
Yeah, and that newsletter is with the second tax notices that go out, and that's end of July, give or take, 1st of August, end of July. So with the waste management, it, we can probably still put some of that in there, you know, and reiterate it, but I think we need a different communications, and if I'm not mistaken, Larry, Mr. CAO, Mr. Adams, that we were going to work with waste management on some type of a newsletter drop in blue boxes, some of those ideas. Brent's kind of nodding his head there. Larry?
This was part of the discussion as well, how to get the news out there, get the information out there, and they have agreed to draft that document with all the up-to-date information on it and outline the pickup dates and that sort of thing. And then we're willing to participate by having it dropped off in the blue boxes as they did their deliveries or their pickups. So that is in process.
Yeah. And I think that's the more timely is what we're looking at this point in time. And we can certainly follow up with, you know, supplementary information with the tax notice as we always have. Okay. Good. Any other questions for Larry? Okay. Then I take it, Mark, that brings us down to bylaws, which we have one of the four or five of them tonight.
Speak to number six.
All right. So the first bylaw is 57 is rezoning lands, and I believe this was recommended by planning a week ago or a couple of weeks ago. Presentation was there, and it's recommended by planning for passing. So the resolution is moved by Rob Thompson, seconded by John A. Bell. Be it resolved that bylaw number 57, 2016, being a bylaw to rezone lands described as part lot 27, concession 6, plan 814, lot 59, 125 Lake Drive, former township of Glenelg, to permit a commercial boarding kennel with a maximum number of 12 dogs at any one time, Stoddard, be now read a first, second, and third time, passed and numbered, and that the said bylaw be signed by the mayor and the CEO, deputy clerk, sealed with the seal of the corporation, and be engrossed in the bylaw book. And I guess one thing that I would say, kennels sometime have some public input, but at the planning meeting, I believe there was three individuals that were here that were the closest neighbors and all supported the Stoddards in their application. Okay. Any other questions or comments on the resolution? Call the question. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried.
Speak to this briefly,
too. Well, you want to speak to this one before I bring it in, Mark?
This bylaw may look somewhat familiar. It was passed in a similar form at the last council meeting. However, the fire chief, Phil Schwartz, was not included in that bylaw. He wasn't noted in the previous bylaw and in the updated resolution, but he had been named in another document, which hadn't been found. So just amending to add Chief Schwartz to the list of Joint Health and Safety Committee.
Okay. Thank you. So the resolution is moved by Don B. Marshall, seconded by Bev Cutting. Be it resolved that bylaw number 58, 2016, being a bylaw to appoint a Joint Health and Safety Committee, be now read a first, second, and third time, passed and numbered, and that the said bylaw be signed by the mayor and the CEO, deputy clerk, sealed with the seal of the corporation, and be engrossed in the bylaw book. Any questions on the resolution? Call the question. All those in favor? Any opposed? That is carried. Okay, thanks, Mark. Bylaw 59 is the bylaw to enter into the LAS installation of LED lighting, somewhat talked about previously under the Infrastructure and Public Works Director's report. Questions? Go ahead, Carol.
Well, I just have a question. Brent indicated there were still some documents outstanding, and should that be mentioned somewhere here, that it's passed subject to receipt of the documents or something?
Brent?
I am confident that I'm going to be able to get those, but if you're worried about that, there's nothing. The insurance is spelled out in the contract documents. It specifically spells out the amount of insurance and things like that. It's just that I want to talk to them and let them put the Municipality of West Grey on their insurance as additionally insured, so yeah. There's a cross insurance policy. That's standard on a lot of contract right. works. It's just so that the two insurance companies can't sue each other, mm-hmm. is what it does.
Well, I mean, that makes every kind of sense.
Yeah.
That's why I think it should be in writing. Didn't you also mention WSIB?
And a WSIB clearance certificate from the contractor doing the work, yes. Mm-hmm. It's only to save or to make sure that we've got a viable contractor doing work
right.
because it's our contract.
Mm-hmm. So is there some way that can be mentioned in there? That
Mark, I think, has an idea of how it can be. He's just kind of whispered to me here. Just subject, at the last of it, just subject to WSIB and insurance certificates being provided before work starts.
Yeah.
Or being added. Yeah. If the mover and seconder, I think that's friendly enough, it's understood, but to your point, Carol, it's in writing, mover and seconder, fine. With Mark making that addition to the resolution at the end, okay? All right, any other questions on? Seeing none, I'll call the question. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Okay. Bylaw number 60. We got that one, Mark?
Yes, bylaw 60 of 2016 is to appoint a municipal weed control inspector. As you may know, Frank Bearns, longtime Gray County weed control inspector, and our municipal weed control inspector for a number of years, had given notice that he did not want to continue with that effective the end of 2015. We had some ongoing discussions with Chatsworth and to some extent Gray Highlands on looking to share a weed control inspector. For various reasons, in particular, the one individual from Chatsworth that has been doing Chatsworth weed control inspection, who's also, I believe, their public works manager, Brad Thake. For whatever reasons, there was some delay in getting back to us, but finally did get back, and Mr. Thake did indicate he would be willing to provide that service. However, his contract would be paid at a rate of $75 an hour. Mr. Bearns's rate was $25 an hour, so perhaps we did get a very optimal service from him at an optimal cost. I was somewhat surprised, although not as surprised, that the original figure quoted, he had done a comparison of other municipalities and mentioned the figure of 125 to 150 an hour, so didn't get him down to 75 an hour. So at least in the interim, I'd like council's consideration to approve this bylaw, and if there's any direction to go out for an RFP or to look at some other options, certainly we can do that. But now we are in the season. We have been getting a couple calls already on giant hogweed in particular, so we do have to have some individual that can respond to it when need be. If there's a call for giant hogweed or any other noxious weed on our municipal road allowances, we do have public works staff that can deal with it. If there's giant hogweed or other noxious weeds on an individual's property that calls concerned about that, we will typically direct them to a local weed control company to call, and they would then privately take care of the noxious weed. But when there's a complaint from one owner to another abutting property owner, for instance, that's sometimes when we do need the weed control inspector to perhaps speak to that individual, and then if that doesn't work, to issue an order for removal of the weeds. So, as again, I would like council to consider approving this bylaw, and then if there's any direction elsewise to look at some other options, I certainly can do that as well.
Comments, Mr. Bell?
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. Clerk Mark, how many times, we have an idea how many times this individual might have been called out last year? Any idea?
I would say Mr. Bearns was probably had to actually conduct site visits no more than six in the year, probably 4 to 6 on average. Although, you know, giant hogweed and wild chervil certainly seems to be the in vogue noxious weed that's becoming more common and more of an issue. Certainly in Chatsworth, that was a big issue, I know. Wild chervil hasn't been so much here yet, but definitely, as I say, a couple calls already on giant hogweed, but it hasn't required the services of a weed control inspector. One was on municipal row lounge, the other was on the individual's property that called, so we directed her to a local weed control company. So you're looking at maybe a half dozen that they actually have to attend a property and provide direction.
Okay. And I don't know what it takes to, shall we say, certify this. Like this gentleman, is he going to be more of a mediator, or is he going to, he's not going to go on the property to get rid of these weeds, is he? Where I'm coming from, I'm just having a little problem kind of understanding why we don't have somebody on our staff that would be able to do this. If it amounts, he is certified?
Yes, there are certification for weed control inspector now. Could we do it in-house? That hasn't been discussed. We could perhaps deal with that at senior management level and see if that could be an option.
Okay, and my point is, I guess I'd sooner pay our own staff $7,500 or $75 an hour than to go out somewhere else and pay somebody else $75 just for clarification, or half that. But anyways, from $25 to $75 seems an awful lot. And yes, we were getting good quality with Mr. Bearns, and he probably didn't raise his rate for a few years either. So I understand that, but it seems pretty hefty.
Okay. Doug? Oh, I'm going to go to Councillor Hutchison, then Rob.
Just a question. What was the term of the contract? It says it can be terminated within 30 days, but what are we talking, a year contract, Mark? Or?
It's open-ended. But the 30-day provision is key, and I have already vetted the contract with Mr. Thake, and I did indicate there could be some current concerns with the terms of the contract, and that's why that 30-day period was installed. But he has, you know, he has graciously at least offered the services in the meantime, because as I say, we do need someone to respond when they are needed. But again, if we can look at some options and make some contact, perhaps maybe there's some other options. If it doesn't work in-house, then perhaps we can look at other municipalities. But I know Grey Highlands is looking at an individual. They don't have one, I believe, at this point, and they are considering Mr. Thake as well. So but we can certainly do some legwork, but with the 30-day provision, I hope council would consider it in the meantime so we can deal with the issue if it does become, it does need some attention.
Rob?
Thank you. I was just going to say, I agree with Deputy Mayor Bell's assumption of all this, but the only thing I'm looking at too is enforcement. As you said, he would issue an order. There's really no one in public works or in that degree can issue a notice. So you'd have to have
Become a certified weed control inspector. That would be added to the duties, and then you'd have that authority to issue the order.
Yeah. So is it going to be cost sufficient by doing that?
I'm not positive what that all entails. I assume there's going to be a course or courses to obtain that certification.
So this may be the route right now.
Keep us in compliance. Councillor Lawrence.
Thank you. I think we should support this. I mean, we have to have somebody right now with a 30-day time frame like that. If they come up with another solution, then it's possible, you know, to make the changes. But in the meantime, as somebody said, we're right in the season, and we've got to have somebody that's qualified to do it. So I would support it.
Okay. We've got it handed out there. I do know, in speaking to Mr. Bearns a few years ago, he was recertified every year. There was a day course at the University of Guelph, I believe, put it on, but he was certified. Now, do you get the certification from the day course, or Brent, I'm saying it's probably two or three different courses, I believe, you have to attend to get that, and then...
Yeah, Mr. Mayor, it is a very in-depth program to achieve, and it's quite costly also. I just... I'm not against venturing and looking into it, but it is very in-depth program and allows you to be an exterminator, so you can use herbicides and things like that. Sorry, that none of us can legally use. So there's a it comes with licensing and approvals and that sort of thing. So it is quite an in-depth program.
Yep.
I think we can bring that information back to the committee of the whole, get that information for council. What would be involved?
Doug?
This comes to mind when you talk about extermination and whatnot. Maybe, what about our local pest control individuals? Are they qualified to do something along that line?
Not on weeds, no.
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 Yeah. They're, spiders and bed bugs and those types of things. But yeah, it's a different animal here when you're talking about weed. I don't know. Maybe if the federal government licenses all weed, we won't need to worry about it. They'll look after the weed. Oh, that's a different weed. Sorry. Yeah, you're right. Okay. All right. Well, with that in mind, I do have the resolution. It's been moved by Carol Lawrence, seconded by Bev Cutting. Be it resolved that bylaw number 60, 2016, being a bylaw to authorize the mayor and the CEO, deputy clerk, to sign a weed inspector enforcement contract position with Brad Thake, be now read a first, second, and third time. Passed and numbered, and that the said bylaw be signed by the mayor and the CEO, deputy clerk, sealed with the seal of the corporation, and be engrossed in the bylaw book. Any questions or comments on the motion? Call the question. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. All right. Thanks, Mark. That brings us down to bylaw number 61. Is the confirming bylaw. The resolution is moved by Doug Hutchison, seconded by Rob Thompson. Be it resolved that bylaw number 61, 2016, being a bylaw to confirm the proceedings of the June 20th, 2016 council meeting, be now read a first, second, and third time, passed and numbered, and that said bylaw be signed by the mayor and CEO, deputy clerk, sealed with the seal of the corporation, and be engrossed in the bylaw book. Any questions on this motion? Call the question. All those in favor? Any opposed? That is carried. Thank you. And that's it for bylaws, Mark. Yes. New business. Are these under new business or new business? And we'll see whether there's direct motions come from them. So these are yours, Mark. I'll let you introduce.
So council recently passed a noise bylaw, bylaw 55 of 2016. And there is a prohibition regarding the playing of musical instruments at certain times or periods. However, there is a provision where an organization or an individual can request an exemption to the noise bylaw, and that in fact is what we have. I have an email from Christelle Owens, who is the executive chair of the Durham Girls Alumni Band, and they are requesting an exemption from the noise bylaw so that they can play their musical instruments while they're holding practices for the Durham Girls Alumni Band at the Spruce Ridge Community School during school year and at the Durham Arena during the summer months. Practices are normally 2 to 3 hours in length, and I did follow up with another email to Christelle. I just didn't have an indication of what time they would go to, and Christelle indicated that they would be done no later than 9 p.m., so I thought that might be something if council entertains passing a resolution for the exemption, that that time may be appropriate to include. So, I don't know if there's any direction from council on that, or...
Any questions, comments? Councillor Lawrence.
6:30 to 9 would cover the times that practices go on. I would like to say, too, of all the times that we have been practicing, and particularly at the arena, there has only been one complaint, someone fairly new to the town. We have had many, many compliments and many, many people coming over to watch, and they like, it brings back memories. They hear us all over town. So, you know, I couldn't even tell you the number of good comments and compliments. And I think the problem that this gentleman was referring to, the drums were practicing earlier before the entire corps started. So they changed that by going to the other side of the arena so he wouldn't hear it.
Okay. Any other questions on that?
The other items include a request to appoint Mary Lou Peffer, who was here in the audience earlier, to the Norman B. Recreation Advisory Committee. And then I do have two other claims for livestock, livestock claims. Another one from Doug Dean, who we did have another similar resolution passed earlier in the council meeting. He suffered the loss of one ram lamb on June 4th with an estimated live weight of 60 pounds and claiming an amount of $180 killed by coyotes. The second claim is a little more interesting. Wayne Boyle of Lot 6, Concession 1 EGR, Glen Elg, he had a calf, a one limo heifer calf with an estimated live weight of 500 pounds killed by ravens, allegedly by the ravens, on June 3rd. However, for whatever reason, Mr. Boyle called the Chatsworth livestock valuer, who attended for on the site, took pictures of the calf, and then that was brought to my attention, and I subsequently contacted our livestock valuer, Jeremy Hanley, but that wasn't until June 6th. So by the time Mr. Hanley got there, obviously time had elapsed and there was further degradation of the body, shall we say, and Mr. Hanley just couldn't say that he had sufficient evidence to, in his opinion, state that it was ravens that had killed the calf as opposed to potentially from natural causes. And even though there were pictures taken by another evaluator. So he has actually, as I say, noted that there is insufficient evidence. So based on that statement from Mr. Hanley, I would suggest if council does approve the claim that the Ministry of Agriculture would not provide compensation or payment back to the municipality. If council denies the claim, there is an option for Mr. Boyle or whoever to appeal that decision. You just submit a letter of appeal, a $25 fee to OMAFRA, and they would have another valuer go out and make an assessment and make a determination. So that's a little bit more of an issue. We haven't had too many of those. I'm not sure of any that, perhaps one in the past, but never an appeal. So I guess I'll be bringing those four items as direct motions, and council can entertain those if with a two-thirds majority and see what transpires.
Okay, so on that, any questions under the new business on any of those topics? Mr. Bell, John?
One little one. Mark, so we do not have access to the pictures.
Yes, I actually have the pictures here.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, Doug? Okay, any other new business? Doug, Councillor Hutchison.
Yeah, just as you may be aware of, there was a news release just recently from Larry Miller, our MP, and it had to do with the designation of the Diefenbaker House as a National Historic Site. I'd just like to read the first couple paragraphs of his release. Recently, the Honourable Peter Van Loan, Member of Parliament for York Simcoe and Conservation Party, Conservative Party critic for Canadian Heritage, introduced a private member's motion that seeks to acquire the birthplace of former Canadian Prime Minister John G. Diefenbaker and convert the property into a museum. Larry Miller, Member of Parliament for Grey Bruce Owen Sound, is very supportive of this motion. And then it goes on to talk a little bit about the birthplace being in Newstead, and it was purchased by a historic enthusiast and who operated and maintained it with volunteer help from the Canadian Royal Heritage Trust. The owner then has recently passed away and left the home to the Government of Canada in his will so that it could be used as a museum commemorating Diefenbaker. My understanding is it's actually the bank has it right now. It's not actually in the hands of the government. Mr. Van Loan made this motion in the House of Commons, and as a result, the Minister of Environment and Climate Change, who oversees National Historic Sites, recently indicated that the government was not interested in acquiring the location at this time. So I just wanted to bring that forward to Council that maybe we look at this in one of our next meetings, or maybe our Committee of the Whole, we can have a discussion about where we think we should go with this and whether we have any options left. So just wanted to bring that to your attention. It was also in the Owen Sound Sun-Times on Saturday. There was a news article about it.
So you want to bring that as a direct motion to support?
Well, I'm not sure, given that they've already turned it down, I'm not sure what our next direction would be, but I'd like to have a discussion on what options we might have. So whether we do that as a motion or we can do that as a Committee of the Whole, I'm not sure where we want to go on that.
I would suggest it goes to Committee of the Whole, seeing as Parliament has, we've got a bit of time to put a resolutions together and or a map towards this. It won't be introduced. The private member's bill will be introduced, but it won't be, as I think it says in the article, until September when it comes forward. But you're quite right. Interestingly, last year in the federal election, it in this riding, it became an issue where all three of the prominent parties, all three candidates, supported the idea. At least two of the leaders, Mr. Trudeau and Mr. Harper, both supported the idea as well too, if I remember correctly. And part of that, because we had a individual from Wes Gray who had certainly done a video and a very extensive project, Mr. Paul Grine, on that, and presented in Ottawa to the Prime Minister at the time, Mr. Harper. So I would certainly like to support it in some way. It goes back to that, how do you put the programming together on it and continue to make it accessible and viable to the country?
I guess my biggest concern with it is since it's been in the hands of the bank for some time, it sounds like if something doesn't happen soon, that it's could become sold to private ownership, and then who knows where it goes from there. So it would be nice when there's an opportunity to do something with it that maybe we could help out in that direction, but I don't know. I'm not sure. So
yeah. I think it would be better if we could have probably a better and more fulsome discussion and get some options in mind here for next Monday when we get to Committee of the Whole. Very good. Thanks, Doug. Okay, anything else under new business? Seeing no more for that, Then we're down to notice of motion or addendums, notice of motion or direct motions. Mark, we have four. That Mark has is a notice of motion, direct motion. I'll need two-thirds majority from council to introduce those. So I'll make that call right now to introduce the four motions. All those in favor? Any opposed? Declare that we do have the two-thirds. You have them drafted up, Mark. Hand them out for mover and seconder on those motions. Okay, so Mark, I think the first one I have is the one concerning the Durham Girls Alumni Band. I have a motion moved by, the resolution's moved by Rob Thompson, seconded by Doug Hutchison. Whereas the Durham Girls Alumni Band has requested in writing an exemption to the West Gray Noise Bylaw, number 55, 2016, in accordance with subsection 6.1.2. Be it resolved that the Council of the Municipality of West Gray hereby provides an exemption to the West Gray Noise Bylaw number 55, 2016, pursuant to subsection 6.1.1, to permit the playing of musical instruments during practices held at Spruce Ridge Community School and Durham District Community Center from 6:30 p.m. to 9 p.m. Yes, right. Where is the Durham Girls Alumni Band? Yeah.
Should have been maybe echoed again here, though. It's up here, but yeah, I should have
Now, okay.
Durham Girls Alumni Band.
Yeah, to prevent the playing of musical instruments, and Mark maybe is saying, by the Durham Girls Alumni Band. Okay. It says it in the first whereas, but. Mover and second are fine with adding that? Okay. There. Okay, I'll let you make the total adjustments to that. Any other questions or comments on the resolution? Carol, Councillor Lawrence.
Mr. Mayor, I'm going to vote on this because I certainly don't have a pecuniary interest. It's the other way around. We put money into it, so there's that. I am a member, but there's certainly no pecuniary interest, so.
Okay. That's very much an individual's right, whether they declare or not, so you've made that explanation, that's fine. Any other questions or comments on the resolution? Call the question. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Okay, what's the next one, Mark? You've got. Okay, we'll see this one. This one's on the livestock claim for Doug Dean. I have the resolution moved by Doug Hutchison, seconded by John A. Bell. Be it resolved that the Council of the Municipality of West Gray hereby approves the following payment for livestock claim. Doug Dean, Lot 41, Concession 2, SDR, former township of Canal, suffered the loss of one lamb with an estimated live weight of 60 pounds in the amount of $180, killed by coyotes on or about June 4th, 2016. Okay. Any comments on the resolution? And this one is being recommended for approval by our livestock evaluator. No other questions? All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Sorry, Mark. Okay. The next resolution is the appointment for the Narnby Recreation Advisory Committee. Resolution's been moved by Bev Cutting, seconded by Carol Lawrence. Be it resolved that the Council of the Municipality of West Grey hereby appoints Mary Lou Peffer to the Narnby Recreation Advisory Committee. Any questions or comments on the resolution? Call the question. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Very good. The last direct motion is another livestock claim, and it has been recommended for non-approval. That's what by our livestock evaluator. So I'll introduce the motion. The resolution is moved by Don B. Marshall, seconded by Bev Cutting. Be it resolved that the Council of the Municipality of West Grey hereby approves the following payments for livestock claim. Wayne Boyle, Lot 6, Concession 1, EGR, former township of Gunnelk, suffered the loss of one limo heifer calf with an estimated live weight of 500 pounds in the amount of $980, killed by ravens on or about June 3rd, 2016. Bev? Councillor Cutting.
Why did he call the Chatsworth? I mean, isn't that sort of the whole start of the problem, is why he, and then there was a time delay to get our guy there, which then again, you know, the carcass was decomposed more so. So is there a reason why he called them, or?
Go ahead.
June 3rd was a Friday. I'm not sure what time he was contacted. Why he knew how to contact the Chatsworth evaluator or valuer when he resides in West Grey or is a ratepayer West Grey, I don't know. Perhaps he didn't know how to obtain the information for our valuer, which I believe, yes, it is on the website, so I can't vouch for why he contacted Chatsworth. But Councillor Thompson may have some more information.
Go ahead, yeah, Rob.
Yes, he left a message on my answer machine, and I got it 2 days later. He didn't know who to call, so he called Chatsworth, the evaluator, and that was the end of it. So, as I say, it was 2 days later I got the message, and that was the message. He didn't know who to call.
I haven't got anything for you. Councillor Hutchison.
Is there any chance, I know when we submit these, we get reimbursed not 100%, right? Through OMAFRA or the organization that we get reimbursed?
Yes, you do 100% for coyotes. If it was dog, the municipality pays if it's approved.
What about ravens?
Ravens, yes.
Yes, 100%. It's so my thoughts
predator,
are...
Deemed a predator, and yes, right. It's one of the ones.
Natural.
So obviously we need to communicate with this individual that they didn't go about this in the right direction, but is there any way or any possibility that since he did go to Chatsworth, that maybe that they would submit it on his behalf since their evaluator went to him and see if they can get it reimbursed?
Since it occurred in West Grey, I don't believe a submission from Chatsworth would be in order.
Why would their evaluator even go out then?
Trying to facilitate, accommodate, hoping perhaps.
But he must.
With photos that our evaluator might consider that as sufficient evidence, but in this case he did not feel, since he did not actually viewed at that time, that he could vouch in his opinion that the ravens in essence killed the coyote as opposed to natural causes, or killed the calf, right. Yes, sorry.
So my suggestion that the evaluators, ours and his, theirs, should look at the protocol and make sure they have it right so that they don't go into other people's territories and expect something to happen. So like
I'm fairly certain our valuer knows that any claim in West Grey is his responsibility. Any claim outside of West Grey is not his responsibility. So perhaps I can communicate that to the Chatsworth valuer, but I'm sure Mr. Hanley is aware of his responsibilities, shall we say.
Councillor Lawrence Carroll.
Is our contact information readily available? Like, I wouldn't have a clue where to look for that, who it is or where you get in touch with them. I mean, and you said it was a Friday. If it was Friday after hours, they wouldn't be able to get the office here.
I think, Larry, are you looking to see whether it's on the website there?
Correct. And but do I we think, have a computer? I mean, not everybody has computers either.
Well,
so,
but that's the whole thing. So if it's after hours, even if you had a phone, you know,
well, if
would
you
it behoove you if you had livestock in that situation that you would have the evaluator's contact? I guess I'm looking at it as, you know, does he have the contact for a veterinarian if he needed a veterinarian? Did
however, maybe it could be on our phone list, you know, when people phone in and you get all of the staff here, but maybe it needs to have that, like our animal control and evaluator. And you know, there'd be no reason it couldn't be there and people could get the information that way.
No, it'd be one of those things we could look at. But in dealing with this situation, there is, as Mark said, if this was denied, the individual has a option to appeal directly to the OMAFRA, I believe it is, Mark, and the process could go through then to be more readily understood as to if there was a mix-up or if there is further evidence coming forward. But the evidence we have, and with our livestock evaluator who has been to the site but just, you know, had no comfort in being able to approve. Carol.
Did he look at the photos, our evaluator?
Yes.
And he could not tell from those?
That was what I understand. Mark, go ahead.
Just didn't feel comfortable from the photos and attending the site 3 days later that, in his opinion, he could categorically sufficiently identify that it was ravens as opposed to natural causes, that any bird or any predator 3 days later might peck at the, well, a little graphic, but at the eyes of the calf, and since it was there for a number of days. But
Doug, Councillor Hodges?
I still go back to the fact that when the evaluator from Chatsworth was notified and he knew that it was in West Grey, does he not know our evaluator, or he would say to that gentleman, hey, you're in West Grey, you should call Jeremy Hanley. And that's his job, it's not my job. Again, it's a communication thing, and I think somehow there was a miscommunication and that's caused this problem.
Okay, thank you. And I think there's certain, my knowledge would be that there would be a connection there between the evaluators from one municipality to the other. Yeah.
It's not on our website.
Is it not on there?
Canine control is on there, and there's a number of other, I mean, Saugeen Valley Conservation Authority is on there, but our livestock evaluator is not. So it needs to go on.
Okay. John.
Mr. Mayor, after much deliberation, I think we should move this thing along. I, unfortunately, who, like yourself, have had a lot of livestock around, and unfortunately, in this particular case, there's too many holes in the story, and I think the evaluator got it right, because there's some timeline differences. There's a calf on here that there's some documentation that's not correct, and I think at this time, I hate to, but I think I have to deny this claim.
Okay. Don, Councillor Marshall.
When these evaluators go out, is there a minimum weight that they put on a calf? I've seen a few calves born. I've never seen a calf come out of a cow that was 500 pounds yet, unless it was a very big cow.
It's one of those holes I was talking about, Don.
Well, we've approved these raven kills with calves before, and they're all 500 pounders.
Yeah.
So I just wondered if there was a minimum amount they put on a cap.
And I don't know that, but total compensation applied for is $980, and that's the most expensive newborn calf I've seen for a long time.
Yeah. Well, it's a 500 pounder, so it's only...
No, it's not.
As it says on the sheet.
Not laying on the ground like that. It's not. Not a newborn.
Yeah, there are guidelines that OMAFR provides to valuers in terms of assessing calves and the weight based on age, etc. So it is something of a judgment call. They will hear the evidence of the livestock owner and then make their own determinations, but there are prescribed values that they get as the market dictates for a calf or a lamb, or and then they ascribe that dollar value per pound.
Any other discussion? Okay, I'm going to call the vote. All those in favor? Those opposed to the motion? That is defeated. Mark, there's been certainly been a few things have come out of this, so we'll make sure that the name is on the website. One, two, the looking at the option possibly for, excuse me, for adding those to the after hours numbers on the phone in. May end up being a couple more, because I don't think on our that our property standards and weed control and those ones are on, but yeah, fence viewer, I would doubt very much if they're on, because that's, yeah, that's got to be an application process to be able to, yeah, so they wouldn't be on there. Okay, where are we at? Closed session. Don't believe we have any other reason for closed session. Then we're down to question period. At this point, we'd ask if there's any questions. If you could go to the podium, Bob, so that state your name so we know who you are, Bob. If it's something from that's. I think it's the gray button there. There you are. Mm-hmm. You're on.
I'm Bob Miller, of course. A couple of things, questions otherwise. Mark is going to talk about having telephone voting. Would that work with a rotary phone?
That can be an issue, yes. There are a few still, maybe in the Alps, that still have rotary telephones. But yes, that could be a bit of an issue.
And we don't have internet back, are we? Neither, so... There we go. Wind turbines. I thought this morning on CBC Radio, when I thought half awake, a few minutes, quarter after six, they talked about some counties, they may have been Eastern Ontario, forming a group to send a letter to the powers that be in Toronto. Now, unfortunately, I can't give you any more information than that. Councillor Hutcherson mentioned about garbage pickup. Is there going to be a change in date for that?
On the garbage pickup, I believe for the rurals in Bentinck, because I think you're saying specifically for yours, yes, there will be a change, because if I'm not mistaken, it was going to be one day, and we were going to do all the rurals, Normanby, Bentinck, and Glen Elg. And was that a Monday or a Tuesday? Right, I think that's on Monday. For the fact of a lot of residents that it's a secondary residence, so on the Monday, if they put it out Sunday night before they went back to their primary residence, then
the Ravens wouldn't get it on by Thursday, but I believe it's Monday. And that notification will be going out shortly.
But our last pickup in Bentic will be a week from Friday. It still will be Friday then.
Yes. Yeah, it doesn't switch until July 1st. So you'll be on Friday.
Yeah.
And then, from what I understand, you'd be picked up on the Monday. So really, if you'll have about 3 days in there. Well, if you have a great Canada Day long weekend, then you'll be able to get rid of the garbage again within 3 days.
Okay. And one more thing. Back about a month ago, we talked about having dark skies. Now we're going to spend $344,000 plus some more for new street lights to lighten things up.
That's been endorsed by the Dark Sky Committee, and I think I can say that Doug, who sits on the Dark Skies, these are LEDs, so that are more directional. And any municipality, urban area that you've seen with the halogen lights or the regular street lights, the Cobra heads, probably it's been estimated some 50% of the light goes up as well as going down. With the new LED lighting, a minimum of 60% less energy used, and two, the light itself, because it's LED, is directed down, so you have a darker sky.
Okay, thank you. Sounds pretty newfangled to me, but it might work.
It has worked in other municipalities very well, and the savings have been recognized with about a 2.5 to a 3 year payback, I believe is what was estimated. Paul. Oh, and Bob shut the microphone off on you. Right down there would be the gray. Yep. There you are. Okay. Yep, you've got it.
Good evening. Paul Gutsky. On page 9, I know everybody's happy with the new library. I'm just wondering if there was an oversight with the entrance, if it should have been put on the front rather than the side, because you're discharging kids into a roadway.
I believe that the... So you're indicating, not discharging on the entrance, but the entrance to the building.
If kids run out of the building from their parents, there's potential that a car is coming out.
There could be potential for a vehicle coming out, yes. There could be potential, I guess, for the children stepping off a sidewalk too, running away.
Right.
But that is the configuration of the building. As long as the business, the former business that was there, there had been no issues.
This is changing to a municipal building though now.
Correct.
So
correct.
I'm just wondering if the entrance should have been on the front where there's no through traffic.
It would have, it requires certainly a considerable amount of adjustment to the building, and it was thought, and I'm going to say, look towards the library member, that it would work, certainly be monitored, and I know that there was some adjustments to the entrance there to have it recessed set back. I guess the thing you can say is the risk. There's risk with getting up in the morning, even with Bob, but I'm thinking that the municipality at this point in time recognizes that it, and it's a risk that we're willing to live and accept at this point in time.
As well
and
as...
Doug, or Councillor Hutchison wants to
Sorry, can I just comment on that, Paul, because I think
Our understanding, I believe, is the front of the library will probably be used for handicap parking, maybe some staff. The rear of the library would be for attendance members sort of thing. And I think, I agree, we maybe have to look at that. You know, maybe there'll be some ways of restricting that or making a, maybe some kind of access way, like to protect that entrance. It's something we'll have to look at, and because it is all new to us.
Right.
So I wouldn't say that, you know, it's going to continue on the way it is. We definitely, if there's a safety issue there, we'll have to look at that. But I think with the parking at the back and maybe the access to the back from the side street, that, you know, you wouldn't get the same traffic going past that door.
Right, or if you could have it one way.
Yes, there may be some options.
That way, everything's visible.
Yeah, so we'll have to look at that once we get closer to being there. So,
right. Rob, sure.
Councillor Thompson, you want to comment?
Yeah, just it could be posted on the building for motorists coming in onto the parking lot for caution, children exiting or entering, whatever. Right. It can be posted, right. Signs.
Hey, put some speed bumps.
Well, anything could be done like that, yeah. Sure. But if you look at some of the local schools, they exit onto parking lots for school buses, and they're a lot larger than the cars going through there, and
right.
There's
right.
No issue there.
Was there any requirements for a sprinkler system in there? That's, I've just,
yep. You know,
it's a new building, it's...
I don't believe that there was. I'm not, I can't sit here and say with 100%
okay.
Certainty one way or the other, but it would have to be inspected by our fire chief to meet those codes.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks. Don't feel left out. 2 out of 3 isn't bad, Janice. If you want to be the third comment, nope. I will say, Janice, if you don't want to comment, it's not a question towards you, but thank you very much for the letter and your concerns with Rockwood Terrace to county councillors. I know that it has got there, and there was compliments on how well it was written and the thoughtfulness of it. So thank you for doing that. And to anybody else out there that feels that way, or has feelings towards Rockwood Terrace, whichever way, to make your feelings known and have the letter written and sent to all county councillors, as you yourself did. So thank you for that. If, you know, questions from a councillor now too.
Yes,
Councillor Lawrence Carroll.
Back to Bob's question about the change in hours for garbage pickup, and it's July 1st. How are we getting that word out to everyone? Please don't say on the website, because people do not sit and look at the Westbury
no.
website all the time.
I don't know whether you were here when that was discussed earlier. Brent said that we are working with, and Larry said that we're working with the contract that flyers would be dropped off in the coming week in all the blue boxes that are there, so that there is a flyer there. The company has agreed to that, I believe, Larry. Yes. And yeah, whether we take out an ad in one of the papers to kind of get it there, and yes, to help you out, it will be on the website.
I think
probably could put it on the sign out here as well.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah, I think it might be a good idea to put in the paper, because a lot of people will pick up their blue box and figure that's just something that was left. The flyer, unless it's very prominent on taped on the side or something.
Well, I know that my blue box is always empty, so
it's not much notice, though. I mean, 1st of July is pretty coming up pretty fast, so
yep.
Only take a week to figure it out. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. See it the next. Bringing it into town. Not for them. It's not a holiday. Yeah. The Friday is the holiday this year. Okay, any other questions? Councillor Hutchison, do you have a motion? Motion number 20. Thank you very much. We'll accept that, Doug. And we stand adjourned until...
July 4th, I believe it is, the next council meeting. Thank you, Mark.